I want an answer from you. Can that be the word of God? Can God inspire such nonsense?
I believe it.
Hmm? Not what you believe. You see,
the Hindus,
they stand before a phallus and say, this is my God.
Yeah.
Do you know that? The lingam.
I didn't know.
You see it in the dictionary. This is the lingam.
Yeah.
They worship lingam in the phallus.
Yes.
It means they worship it. They worship it.
Yeah.
But they say, I believe. Now, can you reason? The Roman Catholics, they take a piece of bread and they say this is the flesh of Jesus. They take some wine and this is the blood of Jesus. So you reason with them. He says, look man, this bread is bread and this wine is wine. This can't become the flesh, starch can't become protein, and the wine can't become blood. Am I right? That's your reasoning with the Roman Catholic.
Maybe a good point, yes.
So the Catholic said that you don't understand. I believe. So you got an answer for that? He said, but I believe that the bread is turned into flesh and the wine is turned into blood.
Yes, sir.
But brother, you see, your senses belie that. You know, the taste of mouth tells you that this is bread, biscuit that you're eating. And the wine is tasting like wine, it's not tasting like blood. But he said, you don't understand, it's a mystery. That's what the Roman Catholic tells you.
Yes.
Am I right? You reason with him, he says, no man.
Yes, because I know like the Trinity.
Right. But now, he said, but I believe. When a man says, I believe, faith without reason is superstition.
Yeah.
We want to reason. Reason, man. Bread is bread, wine is wine.
Yes.
Look, it tastes like it too. A lump of stone is a lump of stone.
Yeah.
In the shape of a phallus, that thing can neither help you nor harm you.
Yeah.
He said, look, you don't understand. He says, for 15 years I was married, I had no children.
Yeah.
And I offered this god of mine, this phallus, this lump of stone, some coconuts, and I got a son at home now. But he said, uncle, somebody might have helped you out. I said, no, I believe that this god of mine gave me that son.
Yeah.
There's no answer to that. He said, but I believe that this is the word of God. This is like a silly goat, an opinionated fool. So, but I believe that the Roman Catholic said, but I believe. The three-in-one fellow says, I believe. This is superstition. You have to back it up with logic, reason. Give me a logical reason why your father should have your mother's hands chopped off for saving his life. Think, man, you eat food, you don't eat. You eat food, and because you eat food, you ought to have clear-cut intelligence.
Yeah.
Read verse 4 now. Read verse 4 of the same. Yeah. Read it.
And the priest...
No, verse 4.
You must not muzzle a bull when it is threshing. You must not muzzle a bull when it is threshing.
The corn.
Okay.
Right.
There is a comma.
Right. Now, that is... there is no context there. It is by itself.
Yeah.
That was beautiful. You see, the Jews...
Yeah.
They used to muzzle the ox, tie up the mouth.
Yes,
when it's threading the corn, trying to loosen the corn. The ox knows that is food, the corn.
Yes,
so while it's threading the corn, it gives a bite. It gets a cob in its mouth and is trying to loosen the grain. And a few grains it gets in the mouth and the thing falls out. So it chews, another 15 minutes, half an hour, gives another bite. The Jews are saying, oh damn it, all this ox is eating up the bloody corn. Tie up the mouth. The merciful God, the compassionate God, he says, don't muzzle the ox. How much is going to eat, man? Let it eat. I can believe that this is God. He's compassionate, he's kind. He's telling us also to be compassionate and kind to animals, them creatures. The God who is so compassionate to the ox, to the bull, he's not compassionate to a human being who saves a person's life. Can it be from the same God? Can the same God be on this level, that to the ox he is merciful, compassionate, and to a human being he is not? Says, feel no pity for her. Your eyes must not pity her.
Yeah.
Whatever she cries, I say, look my dear, I try to help you. I risk my life. He says, chop off her hands.
Yeah.
Now, can you imagine God talking like that? Can God say that?
Well, I must be honest, I don't...
Hmm?
I don't imagine.
Right. Now I'm going to tell you that I have just written an anthology, a book, on the incest in the Bible.
Of what?
Incest.
Okay.
You know, incest? Incest.
Incest, I think, is, let me try, the marriage between relatives.
It's having sex with people with whom you are very closely related. Like having sex with your mother, with your sister, with your daughter, with your daughter-in-law, with somebody else's wife or daughter, that's fornication, adultery. Very serious. In the Bible, very serious.
Yes.
That the adulterer and the adulteress must be stoned to death. That's the Bible says.
That's what the Bible says.
The Holy Quran, the Muslim law is also 100 stripes for the adulterer and the adulteress. Very serious. It's next to murder in Islam.
Yes.
In its consequence, it is next to murder, adultery.
Yes.
So, but if you have sex with your own mother, that's worse than having with somebody else's wife or daughter. That's worse. Going out of wedlock with somebody else's wife or daughter, you know, married or unmarried, it is next to murder.
Yeah.
Very serious. Stone the guy to death, says the Bible, book of Leviticus.
Yes.
That the adulterer and the adulteress must be stoned to death, says the book of God. But now being with your own mother is worse. With your own sister, your daughter, is worse. You agree?
Agree.
That's incest. That's incest. Now, you open up Genesis chapter 19, verse 30, and read that. Genesis chapter 19, verse 30.
Genesis.
Right. Read it.
Later, Lot went up from Zoar and began dwelling in the mountainous region. And his two daughters along with him,
right,
because he got afraid of dwelling in Zoar. So he began dwelling in a cave, he and his two daughters.
Right.
And the firstborn proceeded to say to the younger woman, "Our father is old, and there is not a man in the land to have relations with us according to the way of the whole earth. Come, let us give our father's wine to drink. Let us lie down with him and preserve offspring from our father." So they kept giving their father wine to drink during that night. Then the firstborn went in and lay down with her father. But he didn't know when she lay down and when she got up. It came about on the next day that the firstborn then said to the younger, "Here I lay down with my father last night. Let us give him wine to drink tonight also. Then you go and lie down with him, and let us preserve offspring from our father." So they repeatedly gave their father wine to drink during that night. Also then the younger got up and lay down with him, but he did not know when she lay down and when she got up.
Right. Pass.
36. And both the daughters of Lot became pregnant from their
father. Right. That's enough. Yes. That's enough. Now, you see, I don't know whether you can read this to your sister, this story about the daughters of Lot seducing the father night after night. That means the father is not having intercourse with the daughters, but the daughters are having with the father.
The
father is old, means he's gone cold, must not have an erection, and then he's dead drunk. Now the daughters, how are they going to collect the seed? Your sister want to know, said, "Brother, what happened here? Seed." Oh, this says here, yours is more explicit than the King James Version. He speaks about seed, collecting the seed of the father.
Yes.
He's talking about offspring.
Yes.
That means, you know, have to sex and have children. Right. And thus, both the daughters of Lot will be child by